First of all, good evening. My name is John Regan. I'm your town and school district moderator. I've been asked to moderate this public information session so that we all might get the most out of the time that we have with this panel of experts from New Hampshire DES and the New Hampshire Division of Public Health and Services. I believe Panachuk is here as well. A few items of housekeeping before we begin. Number one, if the fire alarm goes off or if the fire chief instructs you to evacuate the building, this side of the room goes out that door, this side of the room goes out the back door here. Got it? The second point, Litchfield cable committee is recording tonight, so you'll be able to watch this again and again and again. One other note is that we have a population limit in this room, and if we reach it, we may have to close the meeting and pick up at a different time. So just kind of keep that in mind. Okay, so this panel of people off to my left has a considerable amount of information to share. We know that the Litchfield residents and residents from surrounding towns have lots of questions to ask. This session was held also in Merrimack last night. Actively attended, a lot of activity, a lot of questions. We want to make sure we get through all this material. So I've kind of adjusted the format of the meeting to hopefully make sure that we do that. So bear with me. Our agenda this evening, we've allotted 3 hours for this meeting. We'd like to close the meeting down at 10 o'clock. And in order to achieve all those things, all the things we want to achieve between now and then, it's important that we kind of stick to the agenda. There are three basic sections to the agenda that I want to talk about after the introductions are completed. The first phase of the agenda is the speakers will cover their presentation material. And during this first phase, I would propose that we refrain from asking questions during the presentation so that we make sure that we get through all the material that they have for us to review. A lot of the questions will be answered by the material that they present later on in their sessions. So during this first phase, which I'm estimating to be about 60 minutes, 45 to 60 minutes perhaps, we'd like to refrain from asking questions. Now during that first phase, we'd like all of you to start to think about your questions and to write them down. Because in the next section, phase two, we'll be going through a more formal question and answer session. So if you jot down your questions, and that's why I mentioned this paper off to the tables on the right, and this pencil's around someplace where you can write your questions, we'd like you to make sure that you include your name, your street address, a town affiliation if you're not from Litchfield, an email address, just in case we want to or they want to follow up with you in the following weeks and months. Notation, please write daily so I can read your questions. After this first section, when we go through all the material, Troy Brown and I will go through the questions, package them up into similar sections, if you will, and then we'll present them. I'll ask the questions of the panel, and they will go off and answer them to the best of their ability. We hope to get the big questions, the questions that are on everyone's mind, out of the way in this phase two section, and to make sure we get everything covered as best we can. Now, phase three is more of an informal question and answer session, and it's based on how much time we have left up until 10 o'clock. So once we get through, or when we start the phase three section, you're invited to the microphone over here to my left, your right. You can form a line behind that microphone. We'd ask you to, once again, jot down in a logbook or a sheet of paper that we'll have over there your name and address and your affiliation email address for follow-up purposes. We'd ask that you ask your question or make your point, but do so within 3 minutes so that we have an opportunity for everyone to speak. If there is no line, we'll allow a follow-up question. And then once again, the panel of experts will answer the questions best their ability. And at the end of that, we expect to be around 10 o'clock. If sooner, great, but by 10 o'clock, we'd like to close. Any questions? Okay. Introductions. So please allow me to introduce Mr. Tom Burek, Commissioner of the New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services. Mr. Burek has served as a commissioner for almost 10 years. He has focused the department on providing exceptional customer service in all of its programs while also addressing the challenges of a changing climate. Mr. Burek graduated from Dartmouth College and the University of Virginia School of Law. He resides in Hopkinton, New Hampshire with his wife and two children. Mr. Burek, can you join us and introduce your team?
Thank you, John, and thank you very much for being here to moderate this evening's meeting, and good evening, everyone. My name is Tom Burek, and as you've heard, I serve as Commissioner of the New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services. I'm going to set the stage here this evening and say some thank yous. First and foremost, I want to thank all of you, the citizens of Litchfield and surrounding communities, for taking the time to be here this evening. This is not a situation that any of us wanted. And I want to assure you that we are as concerned about this as you are. I and all of my colleagues from New Hampshire State Government, as well as our partners, water suppliers, and partners in town governments, are certainly here because this is our duty to be here. But we're also here because, like all of you, we all have families, and a number of our employees and their families live here in Litchfield and other nearby communities. And we want to help every family, every household, every business in New Hampshire to be assured that when they turn on the tap, they will have safe, clean drinking water. That's our mission, and that's why we're all here this evening. And that's also why state government has rapidly mobilized to learn all that we can about the situation, to establish a site investigation plan with St. Gobain Performance Plastics, to coordinate with the local communities and public water suppliers, and to design and begin implementing a drinking water sampling plan. Tonight, you will hear about all of these efforts and more from senior members of the staffs at the New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services, as well as the Division of Public Health Services of the Department of Health and Human Services. I want to thank Troy Brown, the Litchfield Town Administrator, for his assistance and support in arranging this meeting and providing a clear channel for communications. I also want to thank our partners at Penachuck East Utilities, who provide water to portions of the town of Litchfield, as well as a thanks to the personnel at St. Gobain for first bringing this matter to our attention and for their ongoing cooperation in this investigation. Now, as you will see from the agenda that will appear here on the screen, here we go. I get to make this go.
To your right on the chair.
Even better yet, there we go. As you will see from this agenda, in a moment, I will turn things over to Mike Winsett. Mike, you want to just raise your hand there. Mike is the director of the Waste Management Division. He will provide some background on the chemical family that is of concern and the initial elements of this investigation. Next, Dr. Benjamin Chan, sitting just to Mike's left, is the state epidemiologist, and he will provide information on what we know about the health effects associated with these chemicals. He will be followed by Brandon Kernan. Brandon is the manager of the Hydrology and Conservation Section in the Drinking Water and Groundwater Bureau in the Department of Environmental Services. Brandon will summarize the actions taken to date in this investigation. Next, Clark Frizy, the department's assistant commissioner, right here, one of your fellow residents in the town of Litchfield. Clark will describe our plans for future actions and for further information sharing and communications. Also at the table at the far end here is Craig Wright, the director of our Air Resources Division. These presentations will take about 45 to 60 minutes, as you've heard, and will then be followed by a question and answer session that you heard your town moderator will lead here. We will be joined in the Q&A by Don Ware, who is the chief operating officer, and Chris County, who is the water supply manager of Penachuck East Utilities. There is one last point I'd like to share with you, and that relates to the fact that the contaminant of concern here, something called perfluorooctanoic acid, better known as PFOA or PFOA, is an emerging contaminant. Consequently, we don't know as much about it as we do about many other chemical contaminants. We'll tell you what we know, and there will be questions to which we are not currently able to provide definitive answers. This isn't fully satisfying to us because we'd always prefer to have all the answers before the questions are asked. And we understand that this may not be fully satisfactory for you either. But please understand that as our knowledge evolves, we will modify our approach as appropriate. As you will hear this evening, this investigation is in its early stages, and it will be ongoing for a period of time. Be assured that we will share further results as they become available, and we will be back to talk further with you in the future. We're here with and for all of you, and we will continue to be here with you. With that, I'd like to invite Mike Wimsatt to step forward, but at the same time as Mike's doing that, I would love to invite folks to fill in empty seats. There are quite a few empty seats in front here and in the middle, and even some in back there, and a couple seats right here on the second row. So please don't feel you have to stand. I would love to have you make yourselves as comfortable as you can here. I'll also point out that everything you see here on the screen tonight will be posted on our website, and you'll see a link here by the end of the evening, but you can just go to des.gov and at the New Hampshire website. You'll find all this information there, so there's no need for you to have to try to take photos with your camera tonight of any of the slides. They'll all be publicly available on the website, as will any of the copies of any of the other handout materials that we have here tonight for you. With that, let me turn things over to Mike Wimsatt.
Good evening, and thank you. What I'd like to do over the next few minutes is just to give you a thumbnail sketch of what we know about this family of compounds that we call perfluorochemicals, and particularly PFOA, as Tom just mentioned. So I'm going to get started, and then I'm also going to try to give you a little bit of background on how we got here tonight, what's transpired, and why we're here talking about this and doing this investigation. So first of all, what are perfluorochemicals? Perfluorochemicals, or what often referred to as PFCs, are a group of chemical compounds. They are all synthetic. They are not. They don't occur naturally in nature. They're all man-made, and they're basically long chains of carbon with a lot of fluorines on them. That's the simplest way to describe it. There are a lot of variations, but that's the basic thing that they have in common. They've been used for decades to make products that are used to resist heat, oil, grease, stains, and water. A lot of products that you're all familiar with and that you've used in your homes or in your work. And actually, Dr. Chan, when he gets up to talk about health effects, is going to give an even more detailed description of the kinds of products that they're found in. So then, what is PFOA, or perfluoroactanoic acid? That's a single compound. It's in the family of PFCs. And I've provided you with some trepidation here with the chemical formula. Don't be put off by that. Suffice it to say, it's 8 carbons in a chain with a lot of fluorines on it. And it is used in the production of a lot of perfluorochemicals, or PFCs. It typically is used because it helps in the manufacture of those chemicals. It doesn't actually, in most cases, get incorporated into the chemicals. So it's often used to make Teflon, which you're all familiar with as a trade name for nonstick cooking surfaces. So when it's used to make Teflon, it's used to help make that production process work properly, but it doesn't actually get incorporated into the product. So as a result, you end up having wastes, either solid or liquid or airborne waste that need to be disposed of, and we'll talk a little bit about that. It's often produced, and I hate to give you a lot of acronyms, but it's relevant to the things we're going to talk about tonight. It's often produced as the ammonium salt of the chemical. It's still PFOA, but when it's the ammonium salt, it's called ammonium perfluorooctanoate, which is a mouthful even for me. And so we call it APFO, and we'll talk about why that's important in a moment. And then it's important to also understand that these compounds have been produced in very large quantities on an industrial scale since the 1940s. So that's also relevant to the discussion that we're going to have. So the use of PFOA in manufacturing, as with any chemical, can result in the release of it, in its release to the air, water, soil. And that's relevant because when it is released to the air, in particular, it can be absorbed onto particles in the air, and it can travel on the wind in the air. But then it can settle out to the ground. And when it settles out to the ground, because of its properties, it's able to readily move through the soil, to leach through the soil, get into groundwater, and contaminate groundwater. And we believe that may be a mechanism for how PFOA got in the water in your neighborhood. So it's also important to understand that PFOA is extremely resistant to degradation. And that means that once it gets into the environment, it's very, very persistent, and it stays there more or less unchanged for quite a long time. So as a result of all those facts, we find PFOA in water and sediments and soil, and in fact in the tissue of animals and wildlife and blood of wildlife all over the globe. It's been found literally everywhere in the globe. If we sample those media or if we sample tissue or blood from wildlife, we can find very small amounts of PFOA. That's important to understand. But that also means that nearly all human beings have some level of PFOA in their blood. So if you have your blood tested, no matter whether you've ever had an exposure or you just are human on the planet, very likely we'll be able to find some level of PFOA in your blood. The potential health effects from exposures to low concentrations of PFOA, particularly in drinking water, are really not terribly well understood. And Dr. Chan is going to talk in more detail about that in a little bit. So as a result of all these facts, you know, you've got the circumstances here where you have a compound that's widely distributed, it's been used extensively in industry, it's been distributed around the world as a result of that use, and we don't know as much as we'd like, certainly, about the health effects. So what that means is that EPA identifies those things as emerging contaminants, as Commissioner Burek mentioned earlier. So what that also means is, as an emerging contaminant, we don't have an enforceable standard under the Safe Drinking Water Act by which to regulate PFOA. And that can be frustrating because when we find it in drinking water, we find it somewhere, we're not sure what to do with the number. But what EPA did do, based on the information available, is in 2009 they established what's called a provisional health advisory for PFOA. And that is essentially a number, that they established that at 400 parts per trillion. And that is a number that's basically a health-based concentration above which some action should be taken to reduce your exposure to that contaminant in drinking water. And that number has been calculated by EPA based on the information they have available to them for short-term exposures. And that's frustrating, too, because what we really like to do when we regulate a contaminant or when we're trying to figure out, you know, what risks there are associated with it, we want to have a lifetime or a chronic advisory that tells us, you know, what is the danger of being exposed to this chemical over a long period of time, over a lifetime, say, from birth to 70 years old or older. And EPA and a lot of experts that work with them and a lot of peers outside the agency have been working very hard for many months to develop a lifetime health advisory. We are told and we understand that they will be determining a number, a lifetime health advisory, and releasing that sometime this spring, the spring of this year. So we are anxiously awaiting that information, and that's going to be very relevant to the work that we're doing here. So you might ask, well, why are we doing an investigation here for PFOA? And the reason really is that, you know, many of you, I'm sure, having been seeing this in the news, probably been online, and you've learned, and if you've gone online, you've probably found stories about a plant that St. Gobain has in Hoosick Falls, New York, and another one that they operated in North Bennington, Vermont, where PFOA was released and has impacted drinking water and groundwater. And we were aware of that and looking at this and identified that we had a St. Gobain facility here and getting ready to really look and see if we had something to be concerned about. Simultaneously, St. Gobain, you know, having been dealing with these issues in New York and Vermont, decided to take a look at the situation here. They do have a facility here in Merrimack across the river. And when they looked, they sampled the water coming into their facility. Now, it's important to understand the water coming into their facility, they're connected to town water. So they were really sampling Merrimack Village District water. And when they sampled that, they found consistently over, you know, a number of samples that they collected, about 30 parts per trillion of PFOA in their water. They notified the town and MVD and the Department of Environmental Services of that information, and we immediately took steps to start looking more at what the water quality was in the MVD system, but also looking at private wells and drinking water wells in the area to determine whether we had a widespread problem. So So again, now I sort of just reviewed this. You know, we've got this situation where Saint-Gobain has been reviewing this information in these other states. And if you haven't looked already, if you look, you will see that some significant contamination of drinking water and groundwater has occurred in both New York State and in Vermont. That's what made them do that initial testing. Let's talk a little bit about the history of use of PFOA at Saint-Gobain here in Merrimack, because that's very relevant to what we're looking at here. And I told you before, when I told you about the ammonium salt of PFOA, that that was important. And the reason that it's important is that the PFOA that Saint-Gobain uses here in Merrimack is actually the ammonium salt. And so from now on, when I talk about it in the context of their use of the facility, I'm going to talk about APFO. So again, you can more or less use them interchangeably for the purposes of looking at what we're looking at in groundwater and the concerns we have. But to be accurate, we're going to talk about APFO. APFO is regulated by DES as the toxic air pollutant. That's what we call our air toxics. And when Saint-Gobain came to the agency back in early 2000, late 2000, they wanted to amend their air permit to expand their operations. And we became aware that they were using APFO, and we knew we regulated that. But when they had done testing at their other analogous facilities in New York, they determined that they didn't emit any. And so that was the information we used. So as a result, when we issued a permit in 2001, the department did not set a specific emission standard or require monitoring for APFO. Unfortunately, the information that we got at that time was inaccurate, not because anyone, I think, was trying to fool us, but because the analytical methods that were available at that time wouldn't detect APFO at the concentrations that they were looking for. And so they came back to us in 2004 following some further testing with new improved analytical methods where the detection limits for finding APFO in air emissions in the stack test were much lower. And they said, well, we actually do emit it. And so we ended up doing some direct stack emissions at the Merrimack facility. And when we got the results of those tests, what we learned is that we believed that there was a potential that the facility would violate the air emissions limits, or what we call the AALs, at the facility property boundary. And so as a result, we took immediate action. We entered into an administrative consent order with the facility that required them to phase out their use of APFO. And so that had a pretty quick turnaround, and by 2007, they had reduced their use of that to much, much lower levels. And that basically has been trailing off to a point now where their emissions of APFO are at or near zero. So that's good news that it's not being utilized anymore in any great concentrations. But we did have a period of time when APFO was was certainly being released through their air emissions. So DES, as we've gotten into this investigation, has made a pretty comprehensive information request to the facility, looking for information about their past use and handling of APFO, when it ebbed and flowed, any changes they made, specific information about their waste handling, any specific emissions data that they have, as well as information about any potential accidental releases of the material that they may have had. And Saint-Gobain has gotten back to us and indicated that they will be providing those comprehensive answers. It's going to take some time before we get all of that information, but we are in continuing communications with them, and we're getting information, you know, essentially day to day here. So we will be getting a lot more information about that. We've also requested that they conduct a groundwater and soil investigation at their facility. They have already installed monitoring wells and taken soil samples. And Brandon is going to talk a little bit later about the specifics of that investigation. We don't have the data yet from that investigation, but that's going to be very much of an interest to us to understand if we have a clear pathway for, other than airborne emissions that may have occurred, any releases to soil or groundwater that may have occurred. So with that, that's a whirlwind tour, and I'll be happy to answer questions later. but I want to right now turn it over to Dr. Benjamin Chan, who is the state epidemiologist, and he'll be speaking about health effects for PFOA.
Just a reminder, if you've got questions, just grab my attention or Troy's attention. Maybe you can wave your hand there, Troy, and we'll pick it up from you, and we'll start collecting.
And I thank you, and I just want to reiterate again for those who may have come in a little bit late. There's a number of seats right up on the lower side here. There's 10 or 15 seats open, so if anybody's getting tired, please feel free to come up. We want you to be comfortable. So I know many of you are here tonight because you're concerned about these chemicals and because you're concerned about the potential health effects. And so I'm going to talk very briefly over the next 15 minutes or so about what we know and sometimes don't know about the possible health effects of some of these chemicals. My goal is to try to be as open as transparent with you regarding what we know. But because these chemicals are emerging chemicals, there is still ongoing study in this area. Let me first expand a little bit more on how we're exposed to PFCs. This is a list, a table, I hope you can all see this, that was provided by the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention and an agency within the CDC called ATSDR. That stands for the Agency for Toxic Substances Disease Registry, ATSDR. You're going to hear me refer to them again a little bit later. They are an agency within the CDC's Environmental Health Centers that respond and are experts on chemical contamination. This is a list of the various commercial and industrial products that have contained PFCs, both in your home environments as well as in industrial use. And you'll notice that there's a lot of common products on here, from cookware to fast food wrappings, personal care products and cosmetics, including stain-resistant upholstery, furniture, carpets, water-resistant clothing. Because these chemicals are so useful for their properties of resisting water and stains and grease, they're found in many of the everyday products that are in our environments. For this reason, most people have been exposed to PFOA and other PFCs through everyday commercial products. In fact, in 2006, so just as a point of clarification, sometimes you'll hear me talk about PFCs, sometimes you'll hear me talk about PFOA or PFOA. I sometimes use these terms interchangeably because a lot of what we know about the health effects of these chemicals comes from study of two of the more common PFCs, that's PFOA and another PFC called PFOS. Because these are the more studied chemicals, and because of some concern or potential concern for health effects, in 2006, the Environmental Protection Agency, or EPA, joined with some of the major U.S. manufacturers of some of these chemicals and decided to implement what they call a global stewardship program to phase out production of PFOA by the year 2015. So PFOA has been used extensively in many of our products. Because of this stewardship program, the companies were on track to phase out the use of this specific PFC, PFOA, by the end of 2015. And according to the last report by the EPA, the companies were on track to do this. So the levels and or exposure to PFOA in our everyday home environments should be decreasing because of the phase out. The exposure to PFOA and other PFCs is thought to mainly be through oral ingestion or consumption, and this includes ingestion of food and contaminated water. It also includes exposure through food that has been contaminated, if you will, with PFCs from migration from wrappers and linings of food packaging products. So this has been an issue more in the past, but as it's phased out, this type of exposure through food should become less and less. But as noted earlier, these chemicals can persist in our environments and particularly in our water. Ingestion of contaminated dust is also considered a significant exposure. There have been studies looking at the levels of PFCs in vacuum cleaner dust, and most homes have found PFCs, specifically PFOA, in vacuum cleaner dust in our home environments. Because of this, people are ingesting or potentially ingesting dust in their home environments that contain PFOA. In infants, toddlers, and children, A hand-to-mouth behavior is also a significant source of exposure, so toddlers and children are oftentimes constantly putting their hands in their environment and then putting their fingers in their mouth. This is another way which younger children and toddlers can be exposed to PFCs in the home environment. So also, while breathing is a potential source of exposure, so breathing in fumes, if somebody sprays clothing with a stain-resistant fabric protector, it's possible to be able to absorb PFCs through the lungs, but this is thought to be a more limited source of exposure, and the main way that people get exposed to these is really through the mouth and the GI tract. There's very minimal exposure through contact with skin. This is not thought to, contact with skin is not thought to be a major way that people can absorb these chemicals. So the big question here is, what does finding PFOA in our water mean for our health? And I think the short answer, and I'm going to expand on this, but the short answer is that the long-term health effects are, at this point, still unclear. There are a number of animal studies which have looked at a variety of health effects, but animal studies do not necessarily predict the health effects seen in humans. Animals' bodies process these chemicals differently in several ways, which are important. There have been many health studies or human studies that have looked at a variety of different conditions and health outcomes in humans. And this is a list of what is currently being studied in terms of health effects from PFCs, including PFOA. Now, let me clarify that this is not meant to be a list showing you what people can be expected to have if they were exposed to PFOA. That's not what this list is. This is a list of what is being studied in the science. For some of these health outcomes, there may or may not be strong evidence for an effect between exposure to PFOA and these health outcomes. So I acknowledge this list can be a little daunting and perhaps even frightening, but this is what is currently being studied, and this huge list of health effects is being studied because we're still learning about these chemicals. I will point out that, you know, this ranges from studies to the effects on the liver, effects on cholesterol levels. There has been a study on uric acid levels in the blood. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that. What is uric acid? What does that mean for our health? There has been study on PFOA possibly affecting sex hormone levels that could affect puberty and reproductive development. There has been study on other hormones like thyroid hormones. Study is ongoing in terms of PFOA's effect on the immune system, looking specifically at antibody response after a vaccination. There's not been clear evidence that people are more predisposed to infections, however, as an example. There is a study in terms of effects of growth and development. This includes pregnant women that give birth to children, looking at birth weights, looking at cognitive, you know, brain development, behavioral development, and looking at effects on kidneys, effects on diabetes, and then some types of cancer. I don't know if you can see at the bottom here, that the three main cancers that are under investigation are prostate cancer, testicular cancer, and kidney cancer. Now again, I want to emphasize that this is a list of ongoing study. This is not a list of health effects that people will get because they've been exposed to PFOA. I do want to make you aware, and you may have heard about this study, that this is an important study to be aware of, what's called the C8 Health Project, also sometimes called the C8 Science Panel. This was conducted in about 2005 to 2006 in the Ohio River Valley, which encompasses part of West Virginia and Ohio. This was a study of about 69,000 environmentally exposed community members that lived around a DuPont chemical plant that produced these chemicals, or the chemical PFOA. That chemical got into the environment and led to exposure in the community. This is one of the largest and most important studies of the health effects on people exposed in the community setting. So this is important to know about, and you will likely hear more about the findings of the C8 Science Panel or the C8 Health Project. I will make note that there are other studies aside from this. As an example, there are studies on workers who were exposed in chemical plants, industrial workers. There are studies out there that look at the general population. So because most people are exposed to these chemicals, there has been study on the general U.S. population. We sometimes call this the unexposed population, although you can still find levels of these chemicals in people's bodies. So a little more on the C8 science panel. This involved three independent epidemiologists that reviewed the science and determined whether there was a health link between exposure to PFOA and a variety of different health outcomes. Now, they classified the different health outcomes as having a probable link or not, and a probable link in this science panel was defined as, you know, more likely than not that among class members a connection exists between PFOA exposure and a particular human disease. So I want to mention that this is based on a class action lawsuit settlement. And while this is an important study or an important science to know about, ultimately the findings do not represent the consensus of the medical or scientific community about the health effects of PFOA. But there's certainly weight given to this because it is one of the largest studies of environmentally exposed communities. So this is a list of the different health outcomes that the C8 science panel studied. You'll notice on the right there is the probable link category, which identified six different health outcomes that a panel of three independent epidemiologists thought there was a probable link. Now, an epidemiologist is simply a scientist that studies patterns of disease. You'll notice that the six areas that the three independent epidemiologists thought that there was a probable link to included high cholesterol, thyroid disease, ulcerative colitis, testicular cancer, kidney cancer, and pregnancy-induced hypertension. I'll also point out the list on the left, which they determined showed no probable link, and the large list of health outcomes that were studied that they did not find or that they did not conclude there was a probable link. And this includes a number of different health effects, which I had showed on the previous slide, including diabetes, liver disease, kidney disease. And I'll also mention they did not find a link between PFOA exposure and miscarriages or birth defects, which is oftentimes a concern for people when they're exposed to these chemicals. So keep this in mind. I'm going to talk and come back to this in a few minutes. Now, taken as a whole, so that the C8 science panel study, as well as other evidence and other literature around PFOA exposure, taken as a whole, this is a very difficult set of information to interpret. And part of the reason is because studies are not consistent. So some studies found an association between PFOA exposure and whatever health outcome was being studied. At the same time, other studies looking at the same health effect did not find a connection or an association. Even though some studies found a connection between PFC exposure and health outcomes, it does not necessarily mean that PFC caused those health effects being studied. And the effects may have been due to other factors that were not considered by researchers. This is the difficulty oftentimes with the science and the study looking at exposure of these chemicals in a community and trying to connect them with different health outcomes and health effects, is that connection can be very difficult to make. Finally, some of the changes that were seen in a lot of these studies, while there may have been a statistical association, many of the changes are not necessarily clinically or biologically relevant. And just to, as an example, there are studies looking at the connection between exposure to these chemicals and thyroid hormone levels. And so while some studies have found an association and some studies have not, the studies that have found associations have seen very small, statistically significant changes in thyroid hormone levels that, while you know, are notable in a scientific paper, do not necessarily have clinical relevance, meaning it wouldn't affect what a doctor does finding these differences in hormone levels. So it's very difficult to understand and know what to make of a lot of this literature because of the inconsistencies, because of the unclear effect that it would have on your health. Now, there are some studies that there's more weight. So let me back up. Some studies have more consistently found an association between PFOA exposure and several health outcomes, and these I've listed here. And these are noted by ATSDR. Remember, this is the Agency for Toxic Substances Disease Registry. This is the agency within the CDC that investigates and are experts on chemical exposure. They have recently, back in August of 2015, so less than a year ago, released a comprehensive review of a lot of the literature around these chemicals. And after their review, they have concluded that, you know, well, there's a lot of uncertainty in the literature. There is more evidence to support these four health effects from PFOA exposure. So this includes increases in blood cholesterol, increases in blood uric acid levels, increases in some liver function tests, and lower infant birth weights. Now, my comment about this is, what do these ultimately mean for a person's health? Right? These are what we sometimes call biomarkers. They're tests that doctors can do on people's blood, but what those ultimately mean long-term for somebody's health is still unclear. As an example, liver function tests. So there have been studies that have looked at PFOA and other PFC exposure and have found connections with elevations in some liver function tests that doctors can order. Now, just because somebody has changes or elevations in liver function tests, or for that matter, blood uric acid levels or blood cholesterol, does not mean that that person will go on to develop clinical disease. As an example, there was a recent study published in an environmental health journal that looked at this exact question, and they found a statistically significant association, a connection between PFOA exposure and elevation in liver function tests, but what they did not find was a connection between PFOA exposure and liver disease, such as cirrhosis or fatty liver. And so, while studies have found changes in some of these blood tests, their ultimate long-term health implications are still unclear. In regards to the lower infant birth weights, this was a study of mothers exposed, or there have been studies of mothers exposed to these chemicals, and one of the more commonly found side effects was lower infant birth weights. What this means for the infant's health is unclear. A lot of these infants, you know, regain their weight over time. The changes seen between PFOA exposure in mothers and infant birth weights was very small. And so, again, long-term, the health effects are unclear. Now, I know one of the major concerns, and this was a finding of the Seed Science Panel, was a probable link between PFOA exposure and a couple of the different cancers. This is understandably a big concern for people. Are we at risk for developing cancer from PFOA exposure? And I want to point out that there are two what we call more systematic or comprehensive reviews of the literature, the science between PFOA exposure or PFC exposure and cancer outcomes. There was more recently one performed by ATSDR. This is the report that came out less than a year ago, and also one performed back in 2014 in a toxicology journal. I do want to make note that this scientific review was funded by 3M, which is a company that produces PFCs, and so people should be aware of that while interpreting and reviewing the results. However, you know, ATSDR is part of the CDC and is an expert in this area and independent. So the Toxicology Journal, that's the one on the left, their summary of the cancer literature, which I think still holds some merit, even though they were funded by a company that produces PFCs, is that most evaluations, most of the science, have shown no association between PFOA and various cancers. Positive associations that have been found have been weak, inconsistent, offset by negative associations, meaning some positive findings and some negative findings. Oftentimes, the findings were without a positive exposure response gradient, and that just means that, you know, you would expect the more chemical you're exposed to, the more cancer you would have, or the more cancer you would find in the community. That has not been the case. They have not found such a gradient, if you will. And a lot of the findings are not consistent with animal toxicology or animal studies. And then also, many of the positive associations that were seen between PFOA exposure and cancers were seen in the community setting and not necessarily in occupational settings where workers are exposed to one or two orders of magnitude higher levels of PFCs. So the people that were exposed to more PFCs, the workers in these chemical plants, did not show as consistent findings as what was seen in community settings. And so the author's conclusions from this paper in the toxicology journal are that the evidence does not support that PFOA or PFOS, one of the other PFCs, cause cancer. Now, again, you have to take this with some consideration in terms of the funding, but I will also point out that ATSDR, this is the CDC agency, had similar conclusions, and they state that there is no conclusive evidence that perfluoral alkyls, that's another name for PFCs, cause cancer in humans. Some increases in prostate, kidney, and testicular cancers have been seen in individuals exposed to higher levels. These results should be interpreted cautiously because the effects were not consistently found, and most studies did not control for other potential factors such as smoking. So there have been associations, but what these associations ultimately mean is still not entirely clear because of inconsistencies in the science. So let me just summarize that there's still a lot of uncertainty about what PFC exposure means for a person's health. This is frustrating. This is part of the process, I think, of learning more about these emerging chemicals. Hopefully there will be more information coming. We are talking and working with ATSDR to get some more clear recommendations around what these chemicals mean for somebody's health and what people can do. The health changes with PFOA exposure, the health changes with more consistent findings related to PFC exposure include some blood tests, such as liver function tests, uric acid levels that doctors can perform, but these ultimately have unclear long-term health implications. The associations found between PFOA and several cancers are unclear and oftentimes inconsistent, and need to be interpreted cautiously according to CDC's Agency for Toxic Substances Disease Registry. And further study is ongoing into this issue. I do want to bring up this, or make quick mention of this. Should we get our blood tested for PFOA? This is a question we've heard periodically from communities that have been exposed to these chemicals. And I just want to make mention that, you know, blood testing is not commonly available. There are only a few labs around the country that can test somebody's blood for PFCs, specifically PFOA. So this is not something that doctors routinely know how to order or can easily order. There is, I will make mention, no medical need or no medical recommendation to get your blood tested for PFOA. The reason for this is that while a blood test can tell you how much PFOA you have in your body at the time of the test, What it can't do is tell you necessarily where or how you were exposed to the PFCs found in the blood, and cannot tell you what, if any, health problems might occur or have occurred between PFOA in your body and different health outcomes. And again, the reason for that is it's very difficult to connect exposure to these chemicals to specific health outcomes, and that's especially the case when a lot of the science is still in its developing phase, and there are questions and inconsistencies in the scientific literature. I will make mention that I know that the Department of Environmental Services, out of an abundance of caution, has elected to provide bottled drinking water to anybody whose well water is tested above a level of 100 parts per trillion. And so I know that because of concern for exposure, the Division of Public Health Services and the Department of Health and Human Services, that's who I represent, are willing to talk with individuals who have that more elevated water level and are willing to help get them blood testing if they so desire. Again, it's not a medical recommendation that somebody do that, but I know people are concerned, and so we're willing to work with individuals whose water level tests above a certain level to help them identify ways that they can get tested for PFCs if they so desire. So with that, let me end. I'm happy to take more questions at the end, but let's hear from Greg Kernan, who's gonna talk a little bit more about the process of the testing of well water that has been performed so far today.
Thank you. I'm Brendan Kernan. I'm the manager of the Hydrology and Conservation Section in the Drinking Water and Groundwater Bureau at DES. And tonight I'm going to summarize actions that DES has taken to assess drinking water quality around the St. Gobain facility, as well as activities that St. Gobain is undertaking to assess soil and groundwater quality at the facility. When we issued our March 4th, when we issued our March 4th press release announcing the detection of PFOA in the water supply at the St. Gobain facility provided by MVD, and DES was already in the process of contracting emergency lab services to assess for the occurrence of PFOA in drinking water. You can't just take a water sample and take it to a local lab. You have to find basically an out-of-state national lab. And we sought out some of the best analytical capacities doing this. We looked to a lab that not only looked for PFOA, but for an extended list of PFC compounds, about 20 of them. We also were looking for labs that could look for these compounds at really low reporting limits. We asked that at a minimum that these labs be able to detect the PFCs at 5 parts per trillion. That's beyond the standard 20 parts per trillion that many analytical methods utilize. We also were in the process at that time of procuring emergency sampling supplies, because to sample for these compounds, you need special bottles made of special materials. On March 9th, we had these things in place, and DES initiated sampling both of the active water supply sources for the Merrimack Village District, as well as for drinking water supplies encircling the St. Gobain facility. What we looked for were the closest drinking water supplies that we could get access to on March 9th. On March 9th, we sampled the 3 wells at the Merrimack Village District, or MVD, and we sampled 8 drinking water supplies. These were shipped to the lab, expedited, and an expedited turnaround was requested from the lab. And at night on March 17th, we received the results. The next day, we were contacting the owners of the wells and MVD with our sampling results. We provided bottled water to 2 homeowners that had water supply sources that were above the 100 part per trillion. And we issued a press release announcing the results to the public. All the while we were doing that, we had already had a contingency of supplies shipped in to us before we had the results back. So on March 18th, last Friday, DES was able to hit the ground running with the goal of sampling 100 drinking water supply sources within a 1 mile radius at St. Gobain facility. This next slide summarizes community water, where the location of community water supply systems are to the west of the Merrimack River and Merrimack and Bedford and Nashua, as well as some sampling results that we've obtained working with both MVD and Penacheck Water Works. First of all, I just want to go over what each of these squiggly lines are on this map. In the center of this slide, you'll see these purple squiggly lines. That is this service area for the Merrimack Village District Community Water System. They serve about 25,000 people, and they obtain their water from three wells right now, but they have 3 additional wells that are undergoing upgrades. Nothing associated with this issue. To the north, there's another water system called Cabot Preserve and Greenfield Farms. This is a system that's owned and operated by Penacheck that buys all of its water from the Merrimack Village District. It's called a redistribution system, essentially. To the west, we have another water system called South Egan Woods that is also operated by Penacheck Water Works. It has its own source of water, a gravel well, but it also, at times when they need additional water, buys water from Merrimack Village District. To the south, you can see the Nashua Penacheck system, which serves about 85,000 people. And Penacheck system is connected to Merrimack Village District for the purpose of providing water to Merrimack Village District when they need it. Merrimack Village District does not provide water to Nashua. What Merrimack Village District has done is established emergency interconnections so that they can meet their additional supply and water supply demand should they have an emergency and need additional water supply. Now I'm going to go over the results of the sampling. And before I do that, I just want to clarify, for each of these points on the map, and where the circles are water quality results for water taken from a pipe from the system, and for the triangles, it's a water quality result taken from a source. If you go back to the previous slide, I mentioned we used some of the best analytical methods looking for PFCs down to a detection limit of 5 parts per trillion. fact that you see numbers up here, and I'll go over the numbers for those in the back that can't see it, so I think the contrast is lost as you get away. You'll see that there's a tech for every single source. That's expected. Just about anywhere in the world where you sample a groundwater supply, you're going to see a human background level of less than 10 parts per trillion. My own private well in a town that doesn't have any industry like this nearby would have a detectable level of PFC below 10 parts per trillion. So unfortunately, it is a chemical world. We do leave our footprint with the chemicals we use, and you will detect PFCs just about anywhere you sample them. So as I go through these results, you see the text. They can't necessarily be associated with an industrial or military source of a PFC. So let me go through the results. First of all, Penichuk, on their own initiative, sampled their core system at Nashua at the treatment plant and had a detection, right? The detection of 3 parts per trillion. Clearly a background level, nothing to do with the source that's directly releasing to their water supply. If you go to the west, their South Egan Woods system, which was not connected or taking water from Merrimack Village at the time, had a detection again of 3 parts per trillion, again a background level. To the north, and I should have mentioned before, the South Egan Woods serves about 300 people. To the north, Cabot Preserve, which serves about 1,000 people, had a detection of 36 parts per trillion. Again, they buy all their water from Merrimack Village District, so they don't have their own source of water. Now, when you look at the Merrimack wells, we have results of 3 of them, and we're going to sample the other 3 that are online right now as soon as we're able to. You'll see in the top right here, 2 of the wells tested 90 parts per trillion and 54 parts per trillion. But I need to explain those results. Those are 2 wells called MBD 4 and 5. Those wells operate always together, with MBD 5, the bottom well here, with 54 parts per trillion, being the one that's always on, and the top one, MBD 4, only being turned on occasionally to meet demand, but as a blend with MBD 5. So where you see a 90 parts per trillion value, that's not what's coming out of those 2 water sources when they blend together. MBD 4 never operates on its own. To the south, you'll see MBD 2, which had a detection of 17 parts per trillion. Don or Chris, if there's anything you want to clarify, feel free to. The next slide summarizes the water supply situation in Litchfield. And the first thing I just want to point out to you is a couple things. First of all, the 1 mile sampling area that I mentioned before around St. Clair facility is in the northern part of Litchfield, touching just very small parts of Manchester and Bedford. One key thing about Litchfield is recognized that there's really 2 types of water supply in town. There are those people that are on their own private wells, or possibly on a well associated with the apartment, and then there are those that are connected to the Penichuk core system. About 3,500 people in Litchfield are connected to the Penichuk system. So I'm gonna get to that first. Penichuk, again, on its own initiatives, sampled the 2 wells that they operate, Hudson Owns, in Litchfield, and the results came back at 9 parts per trillion and 7 parts per trillion. And one thing I should have mentioned before on this previous slide, that another source for the system is also the Nashua core system, can feed water up to Litchfield when there's high demand. So that's another source for the customers that are on the Penichuk system. So if you are on the Penichuk system in Litchfield, you have background levels of PFCs in your water. These results, the 9 parts per trillion, the 7 parts per trillion, and on the previous slide, the 3 parts per trillion, indicates that it is not directly impacted by a discrete source of PFCs. This is the type of result you could expect in a water supply anywhere. Another thing you want to see on the slide is around these squiggly lines here, these yellow squiggly lines, is we have different color blocks. These blocks are parcels within the town of Litchfield. The green parcels are the parcels that are actually attached to the Penichuk system, and the blue parcels indicate that there's likely a private well on a parcel because it's not touching the Penichuk system. As you move to the north here, you'll see that the Penichuk system only goes into a small part of the 1 mile radius that we're looking around the St. Cobain facility. So what we've done to date is we've identified the estimated number of private wells within the 1 mile area around St. Gavain facility. And in Litchfield, we estimate that there are 188 private wells. We've also estimated the number of private wells in Merrimack. It's a much smaller number. The service area of Merrimack for the water system covers more parcels, and so we only estimate that there are 14 private wells. After we sampled the initial 8 wells, and then last Friday, mobilized to go back out again, we sampled 95 wells from last Friday through Monday, going door to door in Litchfield. The results of the 95 samples are going to start coming in tomorrow, likely in pieces, and probably in lots of 20 and through next week. The lab got totally swamped when we submitted the 95 samples from the sampling that we did last weekend. The way we went about sampling within the mile radius last weekend is we sent out sampling teams on Friday, and we literally went door to door. We had a list of addresses that we didn't see connected to the Penechuk system, and we asked people for permission to sample in real time. So we didn't take the time to get phone numbers and send letters. Our objective last weekend was to sample 100 wells very quickly and get expedited lab results, and we pretty much accomplished that. We do plan to sample the remaining wells. We have a little less than 100 more wells to sample, and we plan to do that over the next week or two. The first way we're going to go about sampling the rest of the wells within 1 mile radius is we're going to look at who signed in on the sign-in sheet as having a private well tonight, and we'll identify those people that signed in and provided their contact information that are within 1 mile, and you will be sampled in the first part of next week. We will then send letters to all the other parcel owners within the 1 mile radius, asking them to contact with us so we can make arrangements to collect water samples from their parcels as well. And those letters will go out early next week. I will point out that while we were out last week, we were leaving letters in people's doors. It might have seemed a little chaotic to people coming home on a Saturday, Sunday, having a letter with mobile phones or something you might not have been aware of. Thankfully, Litchfield did issue an automated phone call, so it seemed like a lot of people were prepared for us, and everyone was very cooperative and really worked with us really well. So far, we only have results back from the 8 samples that we collected on March 9th, and we got results back last week, and where we issued the press release. Again, St. Gavain being right here in the center of the circle. We sampled a private well in Merrimack, again, not having too many over there. And then we proceeded to encircle sampling on March 9th. And these triangles show the results where we have 87 parts per trillion here. On this parcel, there are 2 wells. We had 190 parts per trillion and 360 parts per trillion. And as you move south, the values decrease somewhat from 49 parts per trillion down to 26 parts per trillion. What this map shows here is all the orange parcels represent the wells that we sampled to date. What the white parcels show are the parcels that we're going to sample over the next week or two. We're going to fill this all in and turn all these parcels orange very quickly and have results back within the next few weeks. Lastly, I just want to go over what effect the substance are going on at the St. Gavain facility. St. Gavain, on its own initiative, initiated an investigation to assess soil quality and groundwater quality at the facility. They picked 6 locations. The Assistant Commissioner Clark Crisey is going to talk about next steps in information and communication.
You said a few years ago you couldn't even test these levels, and now we're parsing out below and above 20 parts per trillion. EPA is clearly going to come down on a number that's lower than 400, and they're spending a lot of money, a lot of effort, a lot of scientists are involved in trying to come up with that. And we wish we had that today so we could tell you, here's where you really should be focused and concerned. We don't have that, so we went out and did the best studies we could, and what we made the decision is, if any well tests at 100 parts per trillion, we will deliver bottled water, as was mentioned. Public Health will work with you to help you understand the benefits or lack of benefits of a blood test and to work with you on getting one. And that's where we're going to operate for now until we do get some better definitive data out of EPA. We are also, for the houses that do test above, looking at alternatives, whether it's connecting to public water or getting a filtration system in. We're not just leaving on bottled water. We'll work on getting a permanent solution. We are going to get the testing done and get all the remaining wells in the 1 mile radius done. That's our number one priority because it lets us see where the next round of testing ought to go. Right now, we just don't have the data. As we saw, we've got 8 data points. We don't know what pattern we should be testing out outside that 1 mile radius. The second we get more data, we'll figure that out, and we'll keep the testing going until we feel we've really got the pattern of the contamination. Anybody who wasn't home when they went out last weekend, you had a card stuck in your door, please use that so we know that you're ready to be tested. If you have the card, you're in the test radius, we want to get tested. We will also be reaching out to people who are in that radius. If you're on public water, but you have a remaining well that was there before and is still operating, we want to know because it helps us fill in that test pattern. And one gentleman I already spoke to tonight identified a great location. We didn't think there were any wells. He's kept it operating for irrigation. Once he turns it back up in the spring, we can test, and that's excellent. That helps fill in the pattern. So please help us fill in this pattern. Next steps with St. Cobain, as we said, we've pushed them to get us a ton of information on all their past practices, and we've asked them to put wells and soil sampling in right now so we can get what the current state is. We have commitments from them that we will have all of the soil and the water sampling data in early April, and we will have a response to all of our questions on past practices by early May. We're going to work through all of those things and make sure we've got that data too. Information communication, this is not the last time we will be speaking. This is the beginning of communication as we go through this process. We do have sign-up sheets over there. If you want to sign up and be on the email sheet, on the email list that lets us communicate with you as we get further results, we would appreciate that. Also, there's a check block if you want to have your well tested. Obviously, well testing is voluntary. We're not forcing anybody to have their well tested. It's voluntary. If you want to be a volunteer, let us know, because as we find the data, we may want to shift the pattern out into a particular area. We want to know who's there. We want to know your contact information so we can get on top of your well fast. We are trying to move this as quickly as we possibly can. Please write legibly. We have found sometimes people do it on their lap. I understand it's hard to write while you're sitting down. Please make it legible. When we go out to test quickly, Brandon and his team did a great job getting out on the weekend and getting these tests done. If your cell phone number is illegible, they're going to call the wrong number. We don't want to. We have set up a website which is listed here. All of the information we have, the handouts we've handed out, the materials you're seeing on the screen today, the pictures you're seeing, the maps, it's all on that site. Any background information, we're putting it up there as people ask questions and identify other things. That's where we're putting everything so you can get it. I believe this is already, Troy, is this already up on the town website, that address?
It will be.
It will be, okay. And so we're trying to make it easy for you to get this information. But if you go on there, all of this is there. We have a series of handouts. We stapled them together. It's four separate handouts. One is the EPA data sheet. One is if you want to go get your well tested before we get to you, help you understand how to go do that. Similarly, water treatment. If you want to go ahead and do water treatment for whatever reason, you know, whatever levels you're at, we have information on what to do there. Everything from an in-house pitcher type system all the way out to a full house system, what to look for as far as symbols on the materials. And then a fact sheet about blood testing, as Dr. Chan mentioned. If you go to your doctor and say you want to test for this, your average doctor is not going to know what to ask for. So there's a sheet over there that will help you in talking to your doctor to get the right kind of test done. And if you do it, you get the right results. Like I said, where we go from here, this is not the last meeting. We will continue to communicate with you face-to-face. If results arrive, we will come back and do more meetings. We'll continue to communicate with the town. Troy has been outstanding. If we've asked for anything, we've had it. We've got communications out to everybody. I know I got my reverse 911 call. And we'll be back. You're going to see us in the field sampling. As you said, we're stacking up sample bottles. As we get data, we're getting back out. We don't hold on to material for very long. And there will be a next meeting. All right. Thank you, John.
Okay, so we're ready for a little break, 5 minutes or so, 5-6 minutes. I've got about 17 questions. If you've got a question to ask, wave your hand. We'll come around and collect it from you.
We'll try to organize them in a simple manner, and then we'll start to ask them on the panel, and they can respond. And as long as we have a civil group, we can maybe have some follow-up questions or questions asked. Okay, so I'm going to convene again in 5 minutes. Okay, so we had an attempt at making these organized, and as soon as I collected the package, I got more questions, and now they're all so waiting. Yep. Sir. All right, so we'll do the best I can, and if we run into something that we've already answered, we'll try to skip it, just remind me. I'll do my best to read these, and I'll not give away people asking a question if they're appropriate. The current concern seems to be centered around ground and how our drinking water is affected. Once we have tainted drinking water, we will have much further reaching consequences. I would like to know if PFOAs have found their way into the food being grown and raised here, and are local eggs, milk, beef, and poultry contaminated or more contaminated than produce from elsewhere? You all have microphones down there, right?
It's an excellent question. It also got asked last night. And to be honest, we're looking for the best experts in the state to make sure we're going out with the best data. We don't know the answer. So at the beginning, as the commissioner said, we'll tell you what we know, we'll also tell you what we don't know. We do not know the answer at this time. We do have people looking out for line test studies. As we get that information, we'll put that into the end of the study.
Would, just to that point, would you say that these questions are all going to end up in a frequently asked questions?
Yep, yeah. Sure. Thank you. Yep. Jim Martin is working diligently on the frequently asked questions page. Part of why we asked you to have your name on there so we can track back to you if we didn't quite understand the question or if we want to give you follow-up information.
True. I have a page two on that one. How high is PFOA contamination in Hoosick, New York, and North Bennington, Vermont? Does anyone know?
I think the highest number we've seen is 2,710.
Wow.
In water.
Okay, how high is PFOA contamination from C8 Health Project, 2005 and 2006? Anyone know?
Yeah, that one got asked last night too, and we'll be honest, we've been so focused on everything else. We took a note to go look back up and we don't.
Okay.
Sorry.
Maybe you want to stand up. Were workers exposed to PFOAs in the studies wearing protection of any sort?
Yes, I believe that's correct that they, I don't believe a lot of them were wearing protection. A lot of the studies looked at inhalation exposure in workers as well. So breathing in the air that was contaminated with PFCs, which is, I'm sorry, I'm getting a...
Stand up.
Oh, stand up, I'm sorry. While breathing is not a significant exposure for these chemicals in the community, I think a lot of the worker studies looked at breathing as an exposure, and I don't believe a lot of them were wearing breathing protection.
Okay. Just to clarify, Litchfield residents who get water from Penichuk, the water is coming from the two wells in Litchfield owned by Hudson, tested at 9 and 7 on the slide. That's correct, right?
Yes.
That is correct. Okay. Is the MVD in the 1 mile radius?
So that means the Merrimack Village District water system, so the community water system in Merrimack, they have a service area, they have customers receiving water within the 1 mile area, but their sources of water are outside that 1 mile area.
And how often will the MDD wells be tested?
We're currently working on a testing regime for them, but the wells will be consistently tested, and that's something that we're having a conversation with them right now.
Okay, next one. How are you going to find out what medical problem this contaminant truly causes? And are you going to take a medical survey?
So the question is about whether there's going to be further health study. And I think that anytime there's chemical contamination, there's typically a process that is performed. And the first stage of that process is to determine what types of exposures may have occurred and to what level the exposures may have occurred, because that information is used to inform any further investigation that's being performed. And so at this stage, we are, the Division of Public Health is working closely with DES on that first part of the process to identify what types and at what levels exposure may have occurred. And so it's too early to answer that question because we're still waiting on information and we're following the situation closely. Yeah.
Are PFCs, PFOAs, persistent in human bodies? How long do they stay in our body?
Good question. Remember, PFCs are a large group of chemicals, and so some persist in the body longer than others, and it depends partly on the number of carbons that are in the chemical structure. So C8 refers to PFOA, which has 8 carbons. That's where the name C8 comes from. And so PFOA has a half-life in the body of around 3 to 4 years. A half-life is the time that it takes the chemical level in the body to go down by half. And so after 3 or 4 years, half of the chemical is removed from the body. Other PFCs have a much shorter life in the body. Other PFCs have a longer life in the body. But PFOA is on the order of 3 to 4 years.
All right, sorry about this. Dr. Alan Hood.
Raise your hand.
I can't read your writing. So help me with this. Explain whether PFOs is based on non-observable adverse effect level, NOAEL, a value or number that ensures safety. That wasn't the one I had a problem. You want to ask that? Maybe you can ask that a little better.
So I understand your question. I'm thinking back to the EPA evaluation. So the current short-term PFOA provisional health advisory level for water is set at 400 parts per trillion. And that is based on a study of, I think, mice or rats that looked at I want to make sure I get my terminology here correct. It may be the lowest observable health effect, which I believe was on the liver in mice and rats. I'm looking at one of my colleagues here, Dennis Pinsky. I don't know if that's accurate or not. He's reviewed some of this. Okay. And then they take that level that was studied in animals, and they extrapolate it for a variety of calculations to come up with this level in humans. Does that answer your question?
It does, and the LOEL for liver, I understand, is a 10% liver weight change.
There's a mic here.
There's a mic on the side if you want to come to it. Sorry. Yeah, put it on. Is it on? There you go.
Oh, so yes, but just for clarification, my understanding is that LOAEL value is based on a 10% liver weight change, and that change is a change that I would characterize as a much lower severity of an ag biological response than many of these scientific studies adverse effects that are being studied. And therefore, such a benign change in the body does, in fact, this PHA level ensure that this level ensures the safety of our exposure to people?
That's a great question. And I think the answer is that the current provisional health advisory level was developed back in 2009, 2010, I believe. And so, sorry, there's a lot of echo here. And so that is why the EPA is currently re-evaluating that level. The 400 parts per trillion is a level for short-term exposure, and so what the EPA is revising it to is meant to be a lifelong exposure level. So we will have more information coming, hopefully, in the last 5 years or so. There's been a wealth of new information on human studies, and so there is certainly more data that the EPA has to go off of for revising their health advisory levels.
All right, this is the one I couldn't read. I understood that one completely. explain 100 parts per trillion into UG per liter? Into microliters. So that residents know whether 100 parts per trillion is below existing PHA or by how much below?
Yeah, that's as important, and I realize that it's very confusing. Micrograms per liter can be described as essentially parts per billion. So parts per trillion, so if you have 0.1 parts per billion, you have 100 parts per trillion. So the answer is 100 parts per trillion is equal to 1 microgram per liter or 0.1 microgram per liter or 0.1 parts per billion. And that could be a 90-minute lecture if I got one.
In other words, we get small. All right, next one. Many wells are in bedrock. Why weren't monitoring wells drilled below the bedrock surface?
Sinkobane initiated the initial investigation to look at groundwater at its facility, and where they put the wells would be where you expect to see contamination initially introduced in the environment, so into the shallow groundwater and then the deeper groundwater above bedrock. A typical path forward, though, when you do an investigation like this is you assess the initial results and see what the trends are both horizontally and vertically going down and deeper. So based on these results, there very well could be additional investigations conducted and additional monitoring points developed, including in bedrock. And there just happens to be a bedrock well nearby that potentially will be sampled in the near future.
Okay. Next one is asked, wasn't St. Gobain called ChemFab years ago? And might any data be gathered from that time and place?
Yes, in fact, all three of the facilities that are in the news, the Hoosick, Bennington, and Merrimack, were ChemFab. ChemFab was taken over by St. Gobain, their operations. So when we're asking for the records, we're asking for all the records. They should have been transferred as part of the purchase to take over a process or a chemical process without having the records. So we should be able to get that information also.
Good. Okay, I got a four-part question. Animals and babies under 100, under 10 pounds, are they more affected or less affected?
I can comment on the human part. I'm a human physician, so I don't know.
Dogs are people too.
I have a rabbit.
Okay.
I'm sorry, give me that question again.
Yeah, animals and babies under 10 pounds, are they more affected or less affected?
So the concern with children is that one, they're still developing, and then two, because of their small body size, they're potentially exposed to more chemical per body weight, right? So a higher view. What ultimately the health effects are, it is still, the long-term health effects is still unclear. So, in kids, there have been a lot of studies looking at birth weight in exposed mothers while they're pregnant. There have been studies looking at the kids' development, their brain development, their behavioral development, development of weight and obesity. And there have been quite a few studies on this, but again, the evidence is conflicting, and it's not entirely clear what the long-term health effects are. But I think the question pertains to more of exposure, as opposed to long-term health outcomes.
I think, Clark, you may have answered this one already. The effect of, if any, on vegetable gardens, produce, food from Litchfield Farm, safety concerns. You said they were still studying it, right? We don't know yet, okay. Is use of a home filter system worth implementing? What precautions are needed for disposal of such systems?
So there are options for filtering with PFOA and other PFCs. The pamphlet that we provided summarizes available technology that could be used in the home to remove the PFCs, as well as references at the end of the document to actual studies that have demonstrated that these type of products can remove PFCs. Relative to disposal, a typical disposal practice for an in-home point-of-use filter would be to dispose of it with your solid waste.
Could all the blasting at Continental Gravel for approximately 40 years have any impact on water, given the water and chemicals used for blasting material?
So the department does have a fair amount of experience with impacts to water quality associated with blasting, and to date those impacts really have been identified on nitrogen as being an issue, nitrates and nitrite, and then possibly in certain scenarios of certain volatile organic compounds. We don't have any data suggesting that chlorinated compounds are introduced to the water table as part of that activity, but because our sampling is sampling every drinking water source that we can get access to within a 1 mile radius, if there is another possible source of PFCs, that'll come out in the data. The data will show that there's a concentration trend that shows there's there's a source other than St. Gobain for PFCs in the ground, in the water table.
The more data, the better.
Sorry?
The more data, the better.
Yeah.
Does this affect shallow dug wells?
Again, we only have initial data in, but shallow dug well has been impacted.
Okay. And you would be interested in testing shallow dug wells as well as deep wells?
We are interested in sampling every drinking water source within a mile of the site. So that would be well points, dug wells, deep sand and gravel wells, shallow bedrock wells, and deep bedrock wells. Okay.
What is the likelihood the PFOs and PFOAs crossed the river from Merrimack? They wouldn't cross the river, they would go under the river, right?
Sure. This is a question that we got last night, and again, there's a lot we don't know yet, so we're not making any snap judgments, but in any circumstance where if you have a contaminant that gets into the bedrock aquifer, most people tend to think of the river as a big boundary, like no contamination can cross it. But the reality is the river's only so deep, and then the bedrock goes for a long way underneath all of that. So if you've got contamination in the bedrock aquifer, that contamination migrates through fractures in the rock. That's how water moves through rock. And if you have a bedrock well, or what a lot of people colloquially call an artesian well in New Hampshire, your well is completed in the bedrock and you're getting your water from the fractures in the bedrock. So if on one side of the river there's a contaminant in the rock, it's absolutely possible and even often does happen that a bedrock well on the other side of the river can intercept fractures that are connected and get that same contaminant. So I guess that's a long way of saying yes.
Okay. I think this might have been answered, but what level of PFOAs would a well have to test at before it would have to be stopped being used?
Well, One, we live in New Hampshire, so we don't tell anybody what to do on your property. I live here. Basically, right now we're at is if your source of water is over 100 parts per trillion, until we get more data, we recommend that you take the bottled water that we're giving to you.
Okay, well, is the water safe to drink, cook, shower in? Drink, we just answered it.
Yeah, if you're testing below 100, I live here too. I live on water too.
And because it was mentioned it was more consumption-based, cooking and showering would be a different topic altogether, would it not?
Well, cooking is consumption.
Right.
Your food tends to absorb the water you cook it in.
I guess you can chill in the shower, don't you?
Showering, coming through your skin is not the way it gets in. It's drinking and eating. Coming through your mouth, not through your skin.
That's correct. The main way is through consumption, very minimal absorption through the skin. And I think that any concern for inhaling like water vapor, shower, that question has come up. That also is unlikely to be a significant source of exposure. I mean, obviously, if people are concerned and their water level is at a higher end, they could consider shorter showers. But again, the main way that people are going to be exposed is through oral ingestion of contaminated water.
And this isn't bacteria, so boiling's not going to do anything to it.
That's correct.
Hey, we're boiling our water. We're putting a filter on the can buttons. Help keep, I think that question's been answered. I didn't see that kind of response. What are the effects on humans from eating plants and animals that have grown using water from? We've already answered that question. We don't know yet. More data to come. You said APFO was recognized as a potential problem in 2004 and eliminated in a quick few years. Does that mean we have been potentially exposed from 2001 to 2006?
Yeah, again, there's a lot we don't know, but it is certainly possible that there has been some contamination in the groundwater. We don't know. We may not, and I want to let people know that we're going to learn as much as we can now, and we're going to try to know a whole lot more moving forward. But if we don't have data from 5 years ago or 10 years ago, we may never know what was in the water or when it got into the water, on what time. But so it is certainly possible that PFOA has been in the groundwater for many years.
Next question, how long has the chemical been in our well? Many years. When was the last time PFOA was tested for in this area? And how was the PFOA introduced to the environment? I think we didn't know that answer. It could come into the environment many different ways, right?
There is regular testing for what we call regulated water systems, which are larger water systems. And Penichuk was tested, and also the MVD system was tested 2 years ago. The first test on MVD, which is the one where we see the highest contamination, came in at 42. So they waited, retested, and it came back as a no detect. Now, the technology 2 years ago, we could not detect below 20. Now we can test down lower. So we don't know what that second test was. It was a no detect. Said some backgrounds expect to see some amount in the water, but the test was considered to be not significantly elevated. Plus, the Hoosick Falls in Bennington have happened in the last 2 years, so we're focused on this much more than we were 2 or 3 years ago.
I think this was answered, but is Penichuk having their wells tested? The answer is yes.
The results you saw were the first round of testing.
On the bottom of the picture, on the bottom of the diagram. Okay. Are town public water wells, such as those that supply our schools, being tested? The schools are supplied by the same wells that the residences are supplied by. Right. So they're provided by Penichuk. So the answer is yes. Will this problem affect town water supply? Water supply is Penichuk or these wells? So yes. If I'm a Penichuk water customer, am I affected by this? Do all Penichuk customers get their water from the same well? I think we've described to where the water comes from, depending on where you are in town. So Penachuck is not affected per se because of the low particulate in the water now, but you're still testing.
Right. It, the results you saw are the Penachuck wells that feed our Penachuck water system that we're drinking from that's in the fountain right there. So they did have very low results. Consider, like it's phrased, the human footprint. When we put our footprint on the earth, you're not going to get a zero. But the levels we saw were not indicative of being next to a source.
This is to the selectmen. How will this impact the value of my home? Turn that microphone off, Frank.
That I do not know. I have no idea. We would have to speak to the town assessors and try and get an answer on that. But we can ask them what their opinion would be on a home that would have a well contaminated with PFOA. But if you're looking at scale of how it would affect a home compared to how much contamination, that's something we'll have to do what we can get our answers on. Just the other thing, John, the town has everything we received, we're trying to put it up on the town website. So that there's links there for any of the documents that the town has received. There's also, we just linked back to the state website that you saw earlier tonight, so.
Good, thank you. Okay, this is a long one. Deep wells, 300 feet, or shallow wells, 17 feet, more likely to have PFOAs. When will school water, not school water we talked about, that's the first. Deep wells, more or less effective versus some of the shallow wells.
There isn't a simple generalization that can be made. I think one would assume a shallow might be more susceptible, but the way hydrogeology works, if a contaminant enters an aquifer in one place and infiltrates and recharges a bedrock aquifer, a bedrock well could be impacted more at a certain location than a shallow well, so it's complex. And we'll have a lot better understanding as we're sampling all these types of water sources in this 1 mile radius.
Okay. Next question was, could the high GMS fluoride levels found 10 plus years ago be somehow related?
I don't know what the GMS refers to.
Oh, GMS, the
elementary. Oh, I'm sorry, okay, great.
Duh. I didn't even know that.
It's only the beginning of what
I know.
That, based on the chemistry that we understand, again, these are man-made chemicals. They don't get naturally created in the environment. And we have no information to suggest that fluoride or fluoridated water or even natural sources of fluoride in water would ever create a situation that would sort of synthesize one of these fairly complex perfluorochemicals. So I think, you know, I have no study on that, I haven't read any papers, but it's hard for me to imagine how that could be true.
That's a good question. You're focusing on wells. What about brooks and ponds and such?
I'm the oceanographer in the crowd, so I get all the water questions like that. That was brought up last night, and one of the good things we've got is the Merrimack River feeds down below, and that's their water source. And they are a regulated water source, so they must test. And their testing has shown low levels. So at least for the Merrimack River, it appears that it's a low level. Penachuck voluntarily also turned on their summer source, which is from the river, and they have drawn a test, which next week we're expecting results? Next week we're expecting the results, so we'll get a measure up here in the Merrimack also. One of the questions last night was impounded lakes. They've got Horseshoe Lake and Natticook, lakes or ponds, over in Merrimack. We are not testing those right now. As we've said, we're concentrating on the wells. We want to get the pattern in the wells. We may seem over-focused on it, but I think we're not
under-focused. I think the question had specifically there was a brook running through some property that animals feed from, whether it would make sense to have it tested.
Right now we're focused on humans and wells.
Yeah. We may have answered this one. How long does PFOA remain in the body? 3 to 4 years. Does it increase? Yeah.
That's the half-life. So half-life is 3 to 4 years, meaning that's the time it takes for the chemicals to go down.
Okay. Does it increase increase in my body over time if I'm ingesting small amounts? Does it increase in my body over time if I'm ingesting small amounts?
That's a complicated question. It depends partly on how much you're being exposed to and how much it's going down in your body. With PFOA, because PFOA in our everyday environment is going away, it's expected, and in fact, national data shows that people's level of PFOA in their blood is going down over time.
Okay. I think we talked about that. Is a wash well more susceptible to contamination than a deeper dug well? Don't know yet. And then this one, I think you answered it in the presentation. Has the specific event that started this investigation, since it was already known more, since it was already known there was some emissions since 2004 being phased out? I think you mentioned that Cobain is not emitting as many contaminants as they were. You answered that line. Go ahead.
Sure. Yeah, we identified the problem in 2005. And we entered into a consent order with St. Cobain that required them to quickly phase out the use of APFO. They did so to a point where, to put it in context, they went from having a product that they used at the facility that contained somewhere on the order of 0.5% or less of APFO back when they first, prior to 2004, and then the consent order that we issued required them to quickly transition, like within a year, to using a product that contained 75 parts per million or less of APFO. So that's been the standard they've been required to meet since 2007, I should say. And then since then, we understand, we're gathering information from them now, they may well be using something that's considerably less than that, but they shouldn't be using anything with more than 75 parts per million.
I think this was covered when studies were performed, what levels of PFC were present in the drinking water in question. Those were all the numbers that were presented on the maps, I think. Yeah. Are Litchfield schools served by Penichuk? Yes. Should Saint Cobain be found responsible for emitting unhealthy quantities of PFOA? What actions would the state of New Hampshire consider taking to ensure no future unhealthy emissions occur? Why did the state not act preventatively after the New York and Vermont contamination revelations?
Just so I get it right, could you repeat the question?
Sure. Should St. Cobain be found responsible for emitting unhealthy quantities of PFOA, what actions would the state of New Hampshire consider taking to ensure no future unhealthy emissions occur? And why did the state not act preventatively after the New York and Vermont contamination revelations?
Thank you. So the first question, let me answer the second question first. We understood, to be clear, the New York Hoosick Falls situation occurred, first was discovered about 14 or 15 months ago. And then the North Bennington situation is about 2 months old right now at the most. So we did become aware of those, and we were looking, and we'd identified that we had a facility here, and I'm talking like January, February of this year, and we were looking to develop a system for going out and sampling. And then while we were working on that, St. Cobain notified us of the test that they took on their water in the facility, and then we were ready to launch it. We went ahead and went out and did the sort of Herculean effort to get sampling done at that time. So that's the story. That's the timing, that's what occurred, and that's the scale and the schedule on which it occurred. And then the first question is, if St. Cobain is found to have emitted, and let's just say for argument's sake, if they found to have caused this problem in the groundwater, we are working very closely, requiring St. Cobain to provide us with a comprehensive set of information. We're going to be getting that information from them in the coming weeks. They also, as we've discussed here tonight, are doing a site investigation, or what we would call an initial site characterization, where they've installed monitoring wells and done soil sampling. Very likely that when we get the data for that, which will come in the next few weeks, we will then ask them to do a complete site investigation, which is a more comprehensive look at their facility, which could also include off-site work if the data that we get suggests that that's appropriate. And if that's the case, then we will be certainly talking with them about fixing the problem. And I guess I'm always a little uncomfortable talking hypothetically, but so let me talk about a sort of a fictional facility. And we have lots of them in the state that have caused groundwater contamination, have had to do a site investigation, and who have impacted groundwater off-site. And what happens when that happens is we have them do a thorough site investigation. If the data that they collect takes them off the site to sample soil or groundwater or streams, that becomes included in the site investigation. And if they've impacted people's drinking water, we look to them to do what is necessary to make sure that everybody who's been impacted by that contamination gets safe, clean drinking water. And there are many, many examples of this across the state, unfortunately. So this is not something we're sort of inventing. This is a process, and these are rules and laws that we enforce and administer every day at DES, and this will be no different. I hope that was responsive to the question.
It covers, yes. We've been told that PFCs and PFOAs are persistent in the soil and water. What is the duration to 100 years or more? We know it lives in the body, but what about in the environment?
Well, I don't know if we know. I can't put a number on it, but you know, we have other contaminants. And again, it's helpful to look at the experience we've had elsewhere. We have other contaminants that actually degrade much more rapidly than PFCs do or PFOA would. And we still have plumes and groundwater contamination at some of those sites that are decades old. So not to sugarcoat it, it is quite plausible that we will have PFOA in the groundwater, even if you didn't have any more inputs. And of course, you could have inputs from just the natural human background that's been discussed, but even without any future inputs, certainly possible that we get that PFOA contamination in this bedrock aquifer for decades.
Could this exposure have been going on for years without the snowing? Yes. It was stated that PFOA usage was reduced significantly after 2001. Approximately testing was done at St. Gobain in 2004. Have other tests been conducted after 2004 prior to the situation? Have other tests been conducted after 2004 but prior to the situation?
Hi, I'm Craig Wright. I'm the air director for the department. I think is the question, was there additional emissions testing done after 2004? I just want to make sure I understand.
Usage was reduced significantly after 2001. Testing was done at St. Gobain in 2004. Have other tests been conducted after 2004?
The original testing was done. There was testing done in 2004, I believe, in New York, where they originally found that they did, in fact, potentially have emissions of APFO. APFO. And then there were some tests that were done in New Hampshire in 2005 out of the stack test. The company had installed some temporary controls. They wanted to test the effectiveness, and so that testing was done in 2005. There may have been some follow-up testing, and I'm looking to my assistant director in 07. I believe there was some follow-up testing in 07, but as you know, as of right now, they've substantially reduced their emission levels because they've reduced the amount of APFO in the inlet stream. So we haven't gone back and done the subsequent testing because it's so low on the input side now at this point.
This ties to you. I think an individual in the area of investigation indicated that he smelled plastics. And does PFOA travel in air? Yes.
Yes.
How far does it travel?
It could travel anywhere from it could be deposited very near the facility to it could travel potentially miles.
Are air tests being conducted?
We currently are not doing any sort of air testing in the area for PFOA. I don't even know if we would have that technical capability at this point in time. We know we can test for it in the stack. I don't know if we can test for it in the air. We would have to look into that.
Okay, thank you. It was stated that PFOA usage was reduced significantly after... Wait a minute, I think I heard that. Yeah, but I did. Can filters be installed at the Penichuk well to remove the PFOA? I guess, so rather than filters at each household, can the filter be applied at the well?
Well, again, current levels, nine.
He was going to say the current levels are pretty low. Background noise levels.
Current levels in the wells are at 9 and 7, so well below what we currently know is a health concern. If the EPA were to come out and say the standard was some number below that, then certainly we would go through the process of installing treatment to bring it below whatever the standard might be.
Thank you. We briefly touched on this one. What types of testing is being done to the local ponds and Litchfields, since there is potential for it to migrate into wells. The focus is on drinking water wells at the moment. Who knows where we'll go if you need to go there. If the PFOA contamination is airborne, is the PFOA contamination airborne or from the ground around the plant? It's airborne.
Actually, it was discovered a couple of years ago that it transports through the air well. We assumed that it settled on the ground, but what was discovered a couple of years ago is it then goes down into the groundwater very efficiently. It's very effective at doing it. So the question is, how does it get to a given spot into the groundwater? And there are multiple pathways. So one of the things we are doing through the studies, the Air Division is modeling from their outputs where it would go. When we finally get the pattern and we know what it looks like on the ground, it's going to help us start to look at which is the most likely pathway. Right now, with 8 sample points, we don't know.
When, where, how, who did the initial concern over PFCs come from? Did people become sick? Was it from a lawsuit or the scientific community? How did we discover this?
So PFCs have been around for decades, and they have not been regulated. And some of the initial studies that were done on PFCs, PFC exposure and health, were in workers. And then there was the larger study that I referred to, the C8 science panel, that looked at exposure in the community, which obviously raised the concern for PFC exposure and health. And so this has been an evolving process from, I believe, what was initially thought as a chemical that was not a health concern, then identifying in workers of chemical plants and some animals that there may be a health concern, and then moving to community studies which showed possible connections between exposure and health concerns. So it's evolved over a number of years.
Okay. Is the EPA doing their own soil testing, or are we relying on St. Gobain's testing?
We're overseeing them doing the sampling. We saw the process they're following. We know which lab they're sending it to. It is an EPA certified independent laboratory, and that's who will provide us with the results.
Good. All right. What administrative actions have something placed on St. Gobain? Administrative actions. I guess would that be penalties of some sort? Mr. Fitzgerald?
What is that your question?
Yeah, the administrative actions have happened since 2001, 2006 from the state.
Okay.
Any corrective actions?
I think Director Wimsatt, when he was speaking earlier about the air emissions, did indicate that in 2006 or 2007, and I forget the exact date, we did enter into an administrative order by consent with the company. The purpose of that administrative order was to put in place a schedule and timeline for them to remove the APFO and go to the lower levels of the APFO in their coatings that they were using at the facility.
Okay, this is a long one. If PFOA usage was phased out or nearly phased out in 2004, it would seem that PFOA levels in the local water supplies would have been highest at that point. Accordingly, the levels that are being discovered now are likely lower than they have been over the past 12 years. Does bottled water usage provide any benefit to us in light of the fact that we have been exposed to the PFOAs unknowingly for more than a decade?
As far as the technical part of that, you know, we don't know yet for certainty how the PFOA got into the water. We don't necessarily know when it got into the water. So, it, you know, I hesitate to say that it's an assumption that the levels were highest in 2004. We don't know that. It's certainly possible. It's possible they were higher. It's possible they were lower. It's possible that it wasn't at the groundwater yet. We just, and hopefully we'll know more. But as I said, there's going to be a real desire to know the whole history, you know, what was the concentration in each year when I was drinking the water. We will probably not know that. Then I want to turn the other part of the question over to Dr. Chan, if I could.
Well, I was going to comment on something very similar, is that just these chemicals persist for long periods of time. And so, you know, the best we can do right now is to identify what the exposure is now and stop the exposure from continuing. But we really don't know what the levels, and we can't predict what the levels would be, you know, 10, 20 years ago. We just don't have that information because the chemicals move and they don't break down.
You might extrapolate by taking statistics now and trending it forward to see what it might have been in the past, right? No? Okay, good. I'm just saying more statistics now going forward, you'll have that much more data to estimate what it might look like.
It seems fair to do that, but there are things you need to know to do that with any reliability that we don't know and that we may not ever know.
Okay. In the health effect studies, not Litchfield, where health effects were analyzed, what levels of PFOA in their local wells were present? In the health effect studies, not Litchfield, well studies.
Yeah, and I think that question was alluded to a little bit earlier, and that the question was asked last night. And it really varies depending upon the community. I mean, there have been studies of this all over the world, you know, including in Danish communities in different parts of the United States. The largest community exposure that I had talked about, the CA Science Panel in the West Virginia and Ohio areas, there were six different water districts involved, and they each had, I believe, different levels of PFOA in their waters. And, you know, those are reported in some studies somewhere, but I don't know the levels off the top of my head. We'll have to do some looking at that.
Okay. I think Clark has answered this one. The current site investigation at St. Cobain is being conducted by whom? Is St. Cobain doing their own site investigation? Did I hear him correctly? Who is ensuring that testing is conducted properly?
The contractor is actually doing the drilling at Stick, which is the one drilling. They are taking from that drilling the samples of the soil, and it's going to an independent lab that is certified. I'm new to this job, but I'm learning those certifications are like gold. People who do this testing for a living will not lose a certification for one event for one company. That's how they run their business, and those certifications are very, very expensive to get. So the lab's not going to do something to play with the data.
Right. And can the people affected close their wells and get water from Manchester?
That's a selectman's question.
Certainly, what we've seen so far, the highest levels that we've got here in town, I'll just stick to Litchfield, are on certain private wells. And if they could get connected to the much lower levels of Penichuk water, that's the best answer. We did notice, actually got pointed out to me by somebody who represents Manchester, that a very thin sliver of Manchester is covered by the study area, and we need to go up and pull their data and find out what their results are up there. But they are a regulated source, so they're tested on a regular basis, and they don't have an elevated rate. So getting connected to Manchester may be a good answer, too. I don't know if Manchester is slightly higher than Penichuk, or Penichuk is slightly lower, one or the other.
I did speak to the water supply manager at Manchester Water Works, and they're going to be doing the sampling that we did to determine their levels in their finished water. So that information we go.
Okay, we're through the second phase of the agenda. The third phase is just to open the mic up to anybody that has any extraneous questions that haven't already been answered. Mr. Phil Reed.
Yes, thank you. First, just an anecdotal story. When the broadcast call went out from the selectmen on 6 o'clock over the Saturday evening, well, both our landline phone and our cell phone rang at the same time. My wife answered it and found out what it was. About 2 minutes later, the doorbell rang, And it was the guy from the DES, he asked for a water sample. And my wife's reaction to that was, Flint, Michigan, eat your heart out. My question, which I think I know the answer, but I want to be sure. Our water was taken for testing, and we gave the inspector all our information, email address, and so forth. Will we get an answer on the status of our water one way or another as to what its level was?
Yes, sir, and I actually meant to go over that. The process we're following is we get data back from the lab, we go through a QA/QC process, we then contact the private well owner, tell them their results, good, bad, and different. If they are going to go on bottled water, we immediately set up an appointment to get bottled water onto their property, and then we announce it publicly. So if you see a press release, we have done everything in our power to talk to every single well owner on that list. As we expand the testing, we may get to the point where we just can't reach out to somebody, but we're going to make every effort to talk to you before we talk to anybody else about your well.
Thank you for the question.
Next question, sir. Can you say your name just so we have it?
Bob Perry from Litchfield. I have a question. Several times it's been mentioned that the circle from the plant is 1 mile. What is so sacred about the 1 mile? Why isn't it 205? For those of us outside the 1 mile circle, does that mean our risk is negligible or there is no risk at all?
One mile is chosen as test radius because if you go up to 2 or say 5 miles, you're actually squaring the area. So if you go to 1 and 5, you might only see that you're on 5 times more, but you're on 25 times more area. As was mentioned, getting these bottles here, getting the test, getting it into the lab and getting it back, we would be spread so thin that even if we had 100 samples over that area, we wouldn't see a pattern. We suspect, do not know, that it's centered on the plant. We want to see which direction the pattern is going, because that might give us a lot of information on what's actually providing the contaminant to the groundwater. For instance, if our wind was from the north, but the ground sloped to the east, which way we see that plume forming would give us a lot of information on what's going on. We want to get that pattern, we want to see it, and we'll spread along the data to get the edges.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Can you say your name, please?
Hi, it's Maria. I was just wondering, in regards to setting up a filtering system, I know we talked about Penichup. My bill comes from Penichup, but it's the Merrimack Valley Water Supply. And those readings were like 70 to 490. I know there's a... Will there be a filtering system set up on those wells, or will you wait until there's an action level dictated by the EPA?
MVD answered that question last night. Unfortunately, we weren't able to join the meeting. They have already hired a contractor to go through and engineer up what the various options are, what they would look like, what they would cost. Part of this is it ends up, you get a chemical mix of the water, both from the ground itself, manganese, iron, and other things. And so it's not like you can just go pick off the shelf, the carbon filter, shove it in, it'll solve all the problems. They have to actually go through and study all of the chemistry of the water, look at exactly what the draws are. Thought you'd pretty good answer. It's a complex question. So they are on the design phase for that. They will have those results. 60 days was the May Board of Directors meeting they were aiming for. So if you watch the MVD Board of Directors meeting in May, go to that, you'll see what they got.
Okay, great.
Any further questions from the audience? Yes, sir. Say your name, sir, please.
My name is Ray Landry. Seeing that it was mentioned that pretty much PFCs, PFOAs are pretty much the majority of everything in our lives, seeing it's man-made. What do we do with our trash? We bury it. So as our trash decomposes over time, we know it makes gases. So do the PFCs, PFOAs, they just go away, or do they decompose the trash and go into the soil with the water? And if so, are the dump sites that we have near the water, are those being monitored?
So the recommendation I gave earlier about disposing of in-house filter media and your solid waste, that's a good option for two reasons. One, in New Hampshire, a fair amount of the solid waste is incinerated at extremely high temperatures that destroys the chemicals to their elements pretty much and destroys PFCs entirely. And so it's a very highly regulated incinerator where solid waste goes to that facility. The rest of the solid waste goes to only, at this point, lined landfills, lined both on the bottom and on the top, such that when you put waste in these landfills, rainwater isn't mixing with the trash and contaminated water. You cut the rainwater at the top, and then you also have the liner on the bottom. And any water that does generate from these landfills is captured as leachate that can be managed as appropriate based on what you see in that quality. So it's a good option. The PFCs would be in a filter media that was designed pull it out and capture in the first place. So the activity of leaching, I wouldn't expect that to occur in a landfill that is really void of any rainfall occurring. There's no liquid being added, and it's also in a media that was designed to hold on to it. So that's why it's a good option.
Thank you. Any further questions from the audience? Mr. Burek would like to close.
First, John, I just want to thank you again very much for moderating this evening's session. And again, want to thank all of you from Litchfield and surrounding communities for taking the time to be here this evening. We have been listening very carefully. We certainly know there's also a videotape to go back and report and look at again. But we've been taking very detailed notes on all of your questions. As you heard, we will be developing a list of frequently asked questions, and we will be posting those and their responses over time on our website. We will be taking all of your comments and questions very seriously. As you heard, as more results come in, we will be sharing those first with the affected homeowners, and then sharing those data publicly as quickly as we can. The investigation that we are undertaking here is comprehensive. We will keep going at this until we are certain that we know as much as we absolutely have to know in order to allow us to make the best decisions working with all of you to ensure that everybody here can have safe, clean drinking water for the long term. So we will be here. We will be here to help you and work with you and look forward to further communications with you as time goes on. So again, I thank you all for being here tonight. Thank the folks in the town for helping arrange this evening's meeting, and thank my colleagues and others for answering questions tonight. Good night. Just made it.